Okay, I think we're live. So this is an impromptu live, and we're going to discuss if crypto and NFTs will transform the music business. So if you are not familiar, crypto is a technology called cryptocurrency, digitized money, so to speak, which is aiming to transform everything we know about everything. But on top of that, we have something else called NFTs. And most people, when they describe NFTs, they just say non-fungible token. But you're like, okay, that doesn't help any, it doesn't help me understand what an NFT is. So before we get into it, I'm gonna say my hellos. What's up, Robert? So this discussion is really open to everybody in the chat who's gonna be joining in. Yes on the beats, what's up? And basically, we're going to just explore crypto and the importance of NFTs into what we'll be doing in the future as people who are of the music business. So I believe and have a lot of faith in this technology as to what it can do, as to where it's at right now, as to the hype behind it. It's very exciting. So if you want to get excited about something and feel the excitement of the people, crypto is definitely a place to look at when it comes to like getting excited about something again, if that makes sense. Remember when Halo 2 first came out? I don't know if you guys are old enough. But when Halo 2 first came out, everybody was playing Halo 2, and that's what made it one of the greatest games of all time, is because everybody was paying attention to Halo 2. So there's something about humans that when we all pay attention to something, it makes it more exciting. And that's the exact same thing happening here. Now there's utility to all this stuff, and we'll get into that in a second. I just want to say my hellos. Room E Beats is here. Made a lot using crypto. There you go. Carino is here. What's up? Robert Music, how are you? I'm pretty good. Maximus 13 is here. R Robo Burr, what's up? And Eseru, yo. I was planning on selling a music place as NFTs. Oh, sorry, I can't read from back here. A music piece, excuse me, as NFT. Don't even know if that's possible. It is possible. And we have some cool news eventually. But yeah, let's break it down into pieces, because as I'm getting into this field, I'm starting to realize like where the majority of people are getting stuck. Because the majority of the crypto talk that you hear is just all people talking over your head about stuff you have no idea about. That's basically the majority of crypto, is people talking about stuff that you're like, what are they talking about? ERC20, ERC721, like what does that even mean? So you automatically think that it's only for the tech people. And that's where stuff gets mixed up. So I'll show you how I've come to understand crypto and what it is and what NFTs are and all these different things. And I'll give you the websites that help me understand it. Because again, my whole job is to make stuff simple. I think right now the world is kind of complicating NFTs. Even NFTs, they'll be like, what's an NFT? A non-fungible token. It means this doesn't equal this. Oops, excuse me. This doesn't equal this. And you could, it's not the same. It's like that doesn't explain NFTs. Like that doesn't explain it to the average folks. So that's what this video is about. Talking about crypto and NFT real quick. I just want to say my hellos. We got two fools in here. He says, I watched the Graham Stephan interview with the techno guy that made 11 million in a day. That's insane. Bari says, Spotty had a lot of success on OpenSea. I'm unfamiliar, but I'm willing to research all those NFT guys, because they are a good community to learn from, because they support each other, because they want to see everybody win. They're not just selfish, focused on themselves. I think that's something that is very different about the NFT community as opposed to the music community. Music, everybody's trying to step on each other's back just to get pulled up. What's up? He made it very interesting. I lost this. Well, I can't read. I need to slow down. Hi, Enter.audio has just been launched, and it's amazing. Dedicated music NFT platform. Are you familiar with Opulous? Is that the thing with, let me look that up. Opulous, better not be no weird website. Opulous, is that the, oh, it's a crypto? Music NFTs and DeFi loans. No, I'm not familiar. I thought you were showing me the thing from PlayStation 2. The Oculus, that's what I was thinking of. The Oculus, not the Opulous. Built for creators and investors, Opulous brings decentralized finance to the music industry, changing how artists access the funding they need and providing a launch pad for the first. So basically, I'll get into NFTs in a little bit, because that's a little more, you have to understand crypto first before we get into NFTs and DeFi and all that. Because if I overwhelm people with information now, they're not going to really understand it. So I want to make sure everybody can get in before I start going in. All right. Need to change the thumbnail. Should probably help. All right. So there's 20 people who are interested. So you're the 20 who actually care about your life. So let's give a little preface. I'll go in a timeline sort of sense. Getting crypto DM me. Yeah, I need to blast everybody that Coinbase thinks I could get some $10. I think you get $10 too, but shoot, I'm about to be an affiliate of Coinbase. Send you out some links. I don't know if that's possible, but regardless, here's what we're going to get into today. We got to start with the economics of America. So firstly, again, I'm not fully versed on everything about everything. I wish I had enough time to do more research, but basically in the next 2 weeks, I think it is, and I can't find it when I most need to find it, but basically there's this economic crisis America is facing right now. And it's all because America, the way it's set up, the way my bank account's set up, America is based on, like, the money we exchange between each other is really not our money. The money we exchange between each other is actually rich people's money that they gave to us to exchange to other folks. Trizza Flock of Flame sent me a video. Let me quickly see what it is, and I will hop back on the mic. So give me 3 seconds, guys. I just have to help Trizza real quick. Okay, I just got to let him know real quick. All right, so give me a second, guys. I'm just helping a buddy of mine figure out something in the piano roll. Just want to show him some stuff real quick. Give me a second. But notice how I put friends first. Not friends first, you know what I mean? Silent one, what's up? Family first, I should say. And then we'll hop right back into the whole explanation of the world. So I'll give you... Trizza Flock of Flame, we're live, and I'll shout you out, theproducerkit.com. So basically, if the velocity is all messed up, Trizza, hit Alt, okay, or Option on the, dang, I can't do this with two hands. I didn't think about this part. All right, hit Alt, and then left click, and it will restore the value like that. Or if you want to control everything all at once, hit Shift, and then left click and drag, and it will copy whatever the thing is. So Shift is copying whatever value you want. Alt or Option on the Mac is resetting it back to its default. All right, so hopefully that helped. Trizza Flock of Flame, he's solid. So go to theproducerkit.com to learn more. They just released a drum pack called Trap Therapy. We might get into it if we have time to make some music. But I really wanted to have a conversation to show you guys the next level of music, and that it's not some hairy fairy off in the distant thing. It's going to come like a storm. And if you think about it, it's going to be similar to, I'm going to say Noah's flood. Let's exaggerate a little bit and call it the flood. We're about to have a flood, so to speak. Now, only Noah and whoever he informed knew about the flood, so he could save people before the flood happened. So we're about to have another economic flood, basically, based on the decisions people made back in 2018. There's a lot of reasons why. I'm not a financial guy. Basically, companies that are so big that they can't fail, meaning that they take out debt after debt after debt and never have to pay it back. And that's the problem with our current economy. Basically, the reason the US dollar is going so crazy and people are so upset about the Fed printing money is because every time this entity called the Federal Reserve prints money, the supply of money goes up. So if you guys heard of supply and demand, it's pretty simple. You have supply and demand. If your supply is low and your demand is high, the value of that thing increases. So for example, if I have the original 150 Pokemon cards and everybody and their mom wants the Pokemon cards and there's only 150 Pokemon cards, the value of those Pokemon cards goes from $1 to $100,000 until you know, the last person who values it says that this is the highest they'll ever pay for a Pokemon card. And that's called price discovery. But basically, the point in saying all this is that when the Federal Reserve keeps printing money endlessly, the supply keeps going up. So it's just like music right now. The reason music is so devalued is not because music is devalued. It's because the internet as we know it, Napster and all them, they devalue the music by making the supply infinite. I can download a Drake song right now and just copy and paste it, copy and paste it, copy and paste it, copy and paste it a gazillion times into infinity. And that's the reason why there's no true value or price on music, because technically there's infinite supply. Okay, but the demand for music can change. It could be a low demand, it could be a high demand. No Squid Games, that's funny. Hold on one sec, y'all. In high demand. So that's basically how stuff operates. So the reason we have such a problem in America specifically is that we keep printing and printing endlessly and endlessly. So the money, for example, every year on average, I think it's 4% of your money goes to crap, which means, let me make sure I don't go too ham. I gotta make sure enough people are in here. I need y'all to smash the like button so that we can spread this message, because I don't like going in unless a lot of people are here. But here's what it turns into is that, you said NFT stands for NoFap training. That's hilarious. What it turns into is that threw me off so funny. Now I forgot my point. Oh, every year when you put a dollar into a savings account, let's look up this, because this was an interesting statistic that I found. Average, average savings rate? I forgot exactly what I typed into Google. Here it is. So on average, if I put $100 into a bank account, every year I would get not even $6. I would get, what is this? 100 times, let's pull up the calculator because I can't count. 0.06%, which is like 0.00. You got to add two zeros and multiply it times 100. So 100 times 0.0006. I would make 6 cents every year on $100 with a 0.06% return. 6 cents. You can make 6 cents by walking down the street. That's not 6%, meaning you would make $6, or 0.6%, meaning you would make 60 cents. You would make 6 cents. 6 cents on $100 every year in a traditional savings account. That's insane. You can move your money in much better places than keeping it in a savings account. But on top of that, the point in showing you that is that your money doesn't go up very much by default, is my point. Now, let's look at the average. This is called, now I'm blanking on words. This is called, somebody help me in the chat, when your money goes down over time. Wow, why am I going blank? I just went blank. That's so weird. So average savings, and then we have deflation or inflation, average inflation per year. Is it inflation or deflation? Now I'm getting it all mixed up. So the inflation rate is around 2%, okay, on average, according to, yeah. So the point is, it gets devalued, okay, is my point, every year. So the problem is, inflation is outperforming your gains on the money. So automatically, by default, by the system, based on how they keep using the system, is that you're losing money every year by default. Just by putting it into a bank account, you're guaranteed to lose your money. Guaranteed. Every single year. And so they don't teach us this in school. Of course they don't. Deflation is when money value goes up. Yeah, I meant to say inflation. My bad. My brain just stuttered for like a quick second. You know how like you have something in your head, but when it's time to say it, it's much different. I had that moment a couple seconds ago. So inflation, my bad, is when your money goes down in value. So again, by default, every year, your $100 loses $2 and goes down to $98. And your bank is only giving you 6 cents. 6 cents is way down here. $2 is way up here. So you're losing money every single year automatically. And what I'm trying to show you is that the reason money, the way it is, the US dollar at least, is the way it is, and we keep complaining about it, is that when they keep increasing the supply of the money, it keeps lowering the value of your money. So not only do you lose a more percentage, you go to buy strawberries at the supermarket and now you have to pay more. So your money's worth less and you're losing a certain percentage every single year because they keep printing more and more and more. It's like monopoly money. It's just diluted just like monopoly money. So just like soda, if you put Pepsi in a bottle and then poured water in it, that's the equivalent of them printing more money. They keep pouring water into the Pepsi over and over and over again until it doesn't even taste like Pepsi anymore. It just tastes like water. And that's what we're getting at. So I'm saying all of that to say the reason why people are so bullish, they call it, or so aggressive investing in cryptocurrency is because you can actually allow your money to earn money and keep, not only allow your money to earn money, but it keeps its value. And so this is what Bitcoin is all about. So this is introduces something called Bitcoin. Bettridge's Law of Headlines. So you guys know more than me. I'm not so versed on everything about finance or crypto. So I don't want to come off like a poser. Link, they'll join. Oh, okay. Thank you, Roomy Beats. Deflationary. There we go. There we go. Now we're getting into it. So it's just like if in music, Bitcoin is basically built to be an expander, a dynamic EQ going up. Whereas money, the way we use it in America, is like a dynamic EQ cutting, going down every time the signal hits. It cuts as opposed to boost. So that's basically what happens. So Bitcoin, the reason Bitcoin is so special is that it basically is a true storing of value. Now that seems complicated and vague, which it is. But all it means is that if I put my dollar into Bitcoin, it will actually stay a dollar. And I'm roughly generalizing because, again, it's going to go up in value over time. And also, this is not financial advice. This is an opinion based on my experience. So you put in your money into Bitcoin, for example, and it will remain its true value of Bitcoin. Because Bitcoin, the special part about it is it has a controlled supply limit, whereas our money has a no supply limit. So remember that equation, supply and demand. So if the supply is low and the demand is high, the value goes up, the price goes up. But if the supply is like infinity and the demand can't match it, then it doesn't matter. The value of that thing will always go down to zero because the supply outranks the demand. And that's what's happening to the dollar, basically. We keep printing and printing and printing it. So the supply is at like gazillion dollars. Let me look at the debt clock or whatever it's called. National debt clock. Let's see how much debt America's in. America is in $28 trillion of debt right now. So when they keep printing these trillions of dollars, what this means is that we're adding more water to the soda. And if we're not refilling the cup with more Pepsi, then eventually the water is going to outrank the Pepsi. And so we're getting to a point where the water is outranking the Pepsi right now. And it's tasting very dilute and bland. So America is having to sacrifice to get it to taste like Pepsi again. They're taking out the water and Pepsi combination and they're dumping it out of the cup. That's basically what they're doing to try and restore the Pepsi flavor that we once had. But that's not how you separate Pepsi and water. You have to do like chemical stuff to separate it back into what it was because they'll merge and create a new thing. And so this is where we're at, $28 trillion, which means nothing to the average person, let's be honest. That doesn't mean much to anybody. All that means is that to the average folks like you and I, it just means that our money doesn't buy the same stuff as our grandparents. That's basically it. So when your grandparents could go downtown with $5,000 and buy a whole house, 30 years later, you go downtown and you have to pay $500,000 to get that same house. That's what I'm talking about. Your money doesn't equal the same thing as before. And so this is why you want to enter Bitcoin at a certain point, because it's the other way around. Because now you go into things like a Bitcoin, for example, you put in, let's say, $500,000, which most people don't have. Again, let's just be straight. Or excuse me, let's make it simple. You put in 500 back in, let's say 2010-ish, which is like the very beginning of Bitcoin. I think there's a Bitcoin to, let me see, Bitcoin investment return calculator. I forget the website, but there's a website where you can calculate if you put in Bitcoin at a certain time. Wait, hold on. I think it's called like how much Bitcoin would I have? Forget the website. basically, if you invested in like 2010, here it is. Okay, so starting date, let's say you invested in 2015. Let's give you a little bit of time. And let's say you only put 500 bucks in back in 2015, just to show you the power of supply. The fact that Bitcoin has a defined controlled supply that will never change. This is the reason why it's so valuable, is because they're not printing Bitcoin after Bitcoin after Bitcoin after Bitcoin. They're not making it go past that 21 million Bitcoin, as Efren said, will only ever exist. So more money. Thank you for explaining that too. And so that's why it keeps going up in value, for example. And also, more people believe in Bitcoin. So the more people you who believe in Bitcoin, and the more it's associated with projects and all these different things, that's what gives it its value as well, the utility of Bitcoin. But we'll get into that in a second when we talk about NFTs. So let's say you put in 500 bucks back in 2015. Let's calculate. You would have $92,000 if you only put $500 into Bitcoin. You would have $92,000 right now if you just put a simple 500 bucks in. So it flips the equation. So again, when our grandparents put in $5,000 to buy that house, and now that same house right now is worth $500,000, it's the same thing. So we are in early in this technology and the investment strategies and different things. And again, this is not financial advice, but you put your money in early. We're not super early with Bitcoin. Bitcoin is kind of maturing, but the point is, you put 500 in now, and in a, you know, let's say 10 years, it's going to be worth 500,000. I'm just making up a number. My point is, it's going to multiply. And in the future, let's say the dollar doesn't even exist, your Bitcoin. So again, that 500 Bitcoin that you bought with the 500 bucks, instead of buying, I'm trying to think what it costs, an Xbox with the $500, you'll be able to buy a house. Okay, hopefully that makes sense. So instead of buying an Xbox today, you can buy a house in, let's say, 10 years with the same exact thing that you traded. So that's the magic of Bitcoin. Now, there's more to it than that, and I try to simplify it into everyday terms. I know I'm missing a lot of small details, but that's the gist of why we're putting the money in Bitcoin. It's because it has a defined supply limit, which means the value will never truly go down, until we get to like what's called price discovery, which it'll fluctuate up and down based on how people desire the coin. But right now, I think we're on the current, it's called the current, the circulating supply is only 18 million Bitcoin. Only 21 million will be made. So we have about 3 million more Bitcoin to be made. And then after that, the supply is finite. So the only way you can get Bitcoin is if somebody trades you Bitcoin for a different currency or different money, basically. And most people are super excited about Bitcoin, but if you look at the market and different things, I'm going to show you guys something in a second. I don't want to bore you guys to tears, but if you look at Bitcoin, the magic of Bitcoin is when institutions come in and they buy a lot of Bitcoin. That's when you'll see these big jumps in the value of Bitcoin. So Bitcoin isn't this thing that constantly goes up into a straight line. It kind of fluctuates based on, again, how much people talk about it. But the point of Bitcoin, I know I'm kind of going in a roundabout circle. The point of Bitcoin is to store value. So it's better than putting it in your savings account. That's what I'm trying to get to. It's better than putting it into physical gold, because at the end of the day, if you put your money into gold, you can't carry gold around. Like, you're not going to carry gold on the airplane to go on vacation. So it's just a place to store your value so that it doesn't lose value, the same way your bank account is losing value by default every single year. And that was my point in showing you Bitcoin. So Bitcoin is just like a better savings account for the most part. Now, all cryptocurrency is volatile, which means it could go up 20%, it could go down 20% in the same day. Whereas most stocks, they don't dramatically change like that. So here's one website. If you're trying to learn cryptocurrency and understand the importance of it, I would start here by looking at coinmarketcap.com. And I'll leave these links in the chat so you can save these on your browser. So CoinMarketCap, PayPal, yeah, I'll get into all the bigger expansions of what all this means in a second. So what this shows you is where people's attention is. So there's a rule in finance called follow the money. And there's a reason for that. Because when you follow the money, you're following where people's attention is, and you're also following where the biggest gains are going to be made, or where the biggest security is. What's up, Marty? Yeah, I didn't even get into what the blockchain is. I didn't get into any utility stuff yet. Right now, I'm just on the surface level. What is crypto? Why is it important? And there's another reason I'll get into in a second about governments and different things. So here's Bitcoin. So come to coinmarketcap.com. And what it will show you is these market caps. So you just want to look at this number and see how big it is. What this shows you is how much confidence people have in this specific cryptocurrency. So that's how I measure it. The bigger the number, the more confidence people have in this market, in this cryptocurrency, excuse me. So this is $906 billion, almost $1 trillion invested in Bitcoin alone. That's just in Bitcoin, $906 billion. That's almost as much money as Apple. Who has, I think, over $1 trillion or something like that. Now, Ethereum, which is, and again, I'll get into the details of all these different names and everything, but basically it's about half of that. So it's $400 billion. So again, these numbers, what they mean to me is that it shows how much confidence the world has in this specific cryptocurrency. And the reason people have confidence is because of a lot of things and a lot of developments in this world. And I'll get into that in a little bit. So again, as you kind of scroll down, you'll start to see other cryptocurrencies that have just as much confidence, if not working their way up to be those two, like Ethereum and Bitcoin, excuse me. So we have Cardano, which is like a privacy type coin, okay? So this has, what, 73 billion invested in it. And then you have, oh, thank you, Benjamin. I'll have to copy that from the thing. And then you have Binance Coin. So all these things are just showing you, going from top to bottom, how much confidence people have in this specific market. Now, I never understood what makes a stock price go up and what makes a stock price go down. In short, it's based on what people are willing to buy. So if you show me a pair of Jordans and you're telling me they're $500, but I'm only willing to pay you $300, it doesn't matter that you're selling your Jordans at $500. I'm only going to buy them at $300. And so that's what makes stuff go up and down in price, for the most part, if we're talking about stocks. Because you have to have a buyer and you have to have a seller. And at the end of the day, the only true value that we're going to get out of any stock or crypto is by the buyer, the person who purchases something. They're going to determine the price. Because if nobody buys your shoes worth $100,000, they're not worth $100,000. It's based on what the market says. Okay, so I'm showing you all this to show you there's multiple cryptocurrencies. They all have different purposes, but this is the easiest way to start to get into it, because you'll start to feel why people are so excited about certain coins like Ethereum. You'll watch it go from $2,800 to $3,300 in a day. So you'll start to feel why people are so excited about this stuff. So this is the first place I've gone to really understand how music and crypto can combine. So right now we're on the surface level, just talking about the currency of the digital world. Now the reason, I know I'm going on a long rant, so I need y'all to pay attention. So the reason people value these cryptocurrencies is because of privacy, for one, and two, because a lot of governments are manipulated by the US dollar. So the reason people hate America is because we go around and we force people to use our money. And if they don't use our money, we'll do things to inflate the value of their money, hyperinflate their money, to where their money value is like nothing. Okay, and then they have to use our dollar. So for example, I tried to do business with somebody in, I think, South Africa, or where was he at? South Africa or one of the South American countries, I forget which, or Venezuela, something like that. And they were like, please, game, like, your program over here cost us like two cars, because they're, to us, $200 is one thing, but to somebody in those countries who's been, America kind of manipulated the economy to make their money worth less, to them, buying our $200 program is like buying two cars. And that's so real around the world. And so what people are trying to come to is find a safer place to where it's not manipulated by governments and manipulated by people with ill intent. And this is why people are so invested into crypto, because there's a lot of tech behind it, but crypto really exists in the minds of men. That's the only real place where it exists. It's a it's based on a network of computers, and there's no one computer that you can just take out and all the crypto disappears. It's based on a consensus type of approach, which means everybody has to agree on things in the computer world. Again, I'm not super technical, but that's the basics of how it works. And that's why so many people in other countries find crypto valuable. Again, to Americans, we're like, okay, I can't use Bitcoin at the store. But some countries, they take Bitcoin because their country's currency was manipulated due to the power structures, and it keeps people enslaved for life. Like I said, to us, $200 is $200, but to them, it's like buying two cars. And so that's why we got to understand, it's almost 30,000 in Jamaica. Whoa. Like, that's what I'm saying. Like, that's how you can go to these foreign countries like the Philippines or Thailand. And, you know, you can get a whole table full of food for $6. So imagine how many of their dollars it takes to get 6 million of our dollars. They'll be working forever, you know, so it's not. So that's what I'm saying. This is why people are so, you know, reliant on Bitcoin, because it resets our understanding of what money is. And I learned recently that back before we had all this stuff. Am I losing you guys? Let me, y'all stand with me. So back before we had all this stuff, it was based on, in America, we had multiple currencies, but nobody really knows that history. I learned this from my mentor, Chris Moyer, for example. He said, yeah, in America, you had different currencies per the, let's just say the different states back then. So let's say Georgia had their own currency, and let's say New York had a separate currency, and let's say the Midwest had their own currency. And so you would have to come to these central locations to trade your currency from the Midwest for New York dollars, or trade your New York dollars for Georgia dollars. So this existed before. This is not anything new, to have multiple currencies. It's just that we grew up to where there was only one currency called the US dollar. We didn't understand other currencies. Like, I'm still taken aback if I were to have to use pesos or Canadian money. It just doesn't feel like money to me. But in the digital world, in the crypto world, there's reasons why we have all these different currencies, because they do different things. Okay, so hopefully that's the foundation. I know it wasn't the greatest explanation, but I'm showing you the history as to why music will need this moving forward. So let's dig more into like NFTs. So NFTs are these things, and I wish I could show you this website, but it's called CryptoVoxels.com, because this is the one website that really, CryptoVoxels.com. So that's the one website that really helped me understand what NFTs were, because I couldn't understand for the life of me why somebody would want to buy an image on the internet for $300,000. It didn't make any sense. But if you played any video game like Grand Theft Auto, for example, this is probably one of the best explanations, is Grand Theft Auto. Because on Grand Theft Auto, let's go to their website, Grand Theft Auto 5. What is that called? Shark Card, I think it's called. So currently, right now, you can buy these things called Shark Cards for Grand Theft Auto online. Shark Cards are where you spend real US dollars to buy fake in-game currency. So let me say that one more time. So Shark Cards are where you spend your real money, cash, US dollars, and you buy this fake currency called GTA dollars from Rockstar. So this is the same thing as cryptocurrency. It's just that cryptocurrency has an actual use outside of a video game. It's the same thing. We're spending our US dollars to go buy $8 million of Grand Theft Auto money. And the same way we build characters in Grand Theft Auto, and we love to show off our cars, we love to show off our character's outfit in Grand Theft Auto, we love to show off. Let me look at GTA 5 online. Let's see what pictures pop up. Hopefully nothing crazy. So this is what people, it doesn't show anything. So we love showing off our the gun collection, our cars, our helicopters, our yachts. We do the same exact thing on Grand Theft Auto for a game where we can't even use any of that in real life. But with the NFTs, it's going to allow us to invest in the same exact thing, basically, but you can get real results from that digital thing. So you can loan against your assets in this digital world, whereas I can't take my Grand Theft Auto 5 account and go to the bank to get a loan. That's impossible, from what I understand. But there are banks or DeFi that allow you to collect these digital things and actually borrow against it. It's called DeFi. And so this is the difference between video games, at least Grand Theft Auto 5, and NFTs. So I don't know if you guys have ever played, what's it called, Neopets? Let me see who's all played. We only have a couple people here. But let me know if you've ever played Neopets in the chat. Just give me a yes. Probably. If I'm the only person here who's played Neopets, then I'm going to feel super salty. Nobody? Okay, that's a nobody. No hands went up. So Neopets was like the same thing as NFTs. You would, because most people think, they're like, okay, I'm buying a JPEG. What use does that JPEG have in my life? But you have to understand that we buy things just because other people want them. Like, there's no real use for a painting on your wall. It's just because you want to see it. So if we're making the argument that you can't use a digital file on the computer, we can make the same argument for art. Technically, there's no use for a vase in our house but to hold a flower. Or if you put a painting on your wall, what's the utility of a painting on your wall? Or what's the utility of paint on the actual wall? And so people who bring the argument that there's no utility to something, I always ask them, if there's no utility, that doesn't make it not valuable. Okay, so hopefully I'm arguing to some degree on that point. So again, the easiest way to understand this is if you play Grand Theft Auto 5, you say your Neopets are starving, that's hilarious. If you've ever played Grand Theft Auto 5, you know that there's digital money on there. You can buy these things called shark cards with real US dollars to buy fake online money. So the same thing is kind of happening with crypto. However, crypto, it has an actual use, an actual purpose. Put my money in Binance, save me. Oh, there you go. Yeah, staking and all that, that's high level DeFi stuff. So trying to simplify this for the next level of folks. So now that you understand what Bitcoin is, why there's so much hype around it, and why people exchange their money for fake money, basically, I'm not going to say fake money, but for other digital money, let's say, and then understand that that digital money can get you digital things that equal real things. Now we're getting into NFTs. Okay, so I'm going to work on my presentation because it's not the most connected presentation. But if you want to study NFTs, start with these things called CryptoPunks. So I think Snoop Dogg bought one, or Jay-Z bought one. Somebody bought some. Who was the other person? Jay-Z. I think Jason Derulo was the other one. And so CryptoPunks are essentially a simple file that are pixelated like this. TikTok has NFTs. Yeah, I heard a lot of social media is starting to make NFTs too. And without even getting into the blockchain and all this, let's just go through an NFT and what it is real quick. So an NFT is a digital thing. And let's go to actually a site called Rarible because that's a little bit easier. But you're going to hear about these things called CryptoPunks first. You're probably going to hear about these for the majority of your time talking about NFTs. So these are like one of the first standout projects on what's called the blockchain. Okay, so the blockchain is basically a place where you do stuff that can't be changed forever. That's basically what it is. There's too much to explain about the blockchain and about smart contracts and all this. I don't want to make it too complicated, but the blockchain is basically a place where you can verify things for fact and they can't change. So that's the reason why the blockchain is so valuable, is because people can't lie, they can't cheat, they can't steal. Now there's caveats to what I just said, but basically, you know, that's what it comes down to. So there are these things called CryptoPunks, which are put on a specific blockchain, and they're valued because people just wanted to value them. That's just what it is. Because what other utility is there for a picture on a computer except the fact that you value it? The same way I can put a piece of art on my wall, the value of the art is because I value it that way. There's no utility for the art. I can't take the art and start digging a hole with it. I guess I could. There's no purpose for the art except for the feeling that you get from it and the value that you give to it. So the same thing with this digital art. Now these pieces are going for a minimum of $400,000+ US dollars, but they calculate in what's called Ethereum, So the bottom level CryptoPunk, the current lowest price for a CryptoPunk is a $500,000 almost. And what this is showing us is that people are putting their value in this digital asset because everybody wants it. Remember, when supply is low and demand is high, the value goes up. So the CryptoPunks, I think there was only, how many CryptoPunks are there? I think it said like 9,099. Where's it at? Let's just say there's 1,000. Let's say there's 10,000 CryptoPunks. Even if there's 10,000, there's 7 billion people in the world. So there's only 10,000 of these things, but there's 7 billion people who want those 10,000 things. And so the demand outranks the supply. So the price and the value of these CryptoPunks keeps going up and up and up because everybody keeps talking about it. Everybody wants it. So everybody is starting to increase the value because more and more people want it. And that's how the lowest price of this thing is at $500,000, which is pretty insane. And so if you play Neopets as a kid, you'll know that there's these items on Neopets that didn't have an actual use for your Neopet. They were just collectibles. So there was something called a what's it called, a Mystic Stone or something stone. Darn, what was that thing called? I used to buy these all the time. If I remember what it's called, not a soothing stone, but a what's that thing called? Let me look it up. Popular Neopet items. So in the game Neopets, the goal of it is to keep your little pet alive and just have a store make money. It was basically a really good game about supply and demand and what marketing is. But let me see if I can open this up. 28 nostalgic things only people who play Neopets will remember. So for those who haven't played Neopets, it's a really good lesson on what we're currently in right now. So on Neopets, you have this digital pet, and you would change its color, and you would try to get the special ones because the special ones were cooler. But the problem was, in order to get a special Neopet, you had to. It was really hard to do it, basically. So the common Neopets weren't as wanted because everybody could get them, but the rare ones were really, everybody wanted them because they were hard to get. Again, low supply, high demand. So that's the first lesson of Neopets. And then you could change the color so you really felt like it was your pet, your online pet. Then you scroll down and you made these things called Neo points. So look at Neo points as your digital kind of cryptocurrency. It's a digital currency that technically means nothing until it means something. So the fact that I had a half a million Neo points on this game meant nothing because I can't change those things for something else. It's non-fungible. It means I can earn 500,000 Neo points, but I can't trade Neo points for dollars. There's no equivalent of what a Neo point is until somebody wants to trade me for it. So that's where the non-fungible part comes into play. Then we go down here, and that's kind of beside the point, this money tree thing. But here's something that, what's up, Castro? So remember I said that people value their Neopet because they could personalize the color of their Neopet. So there were these things called paintbrushes. So in the beginning of the Neopets game, you could have red, yellow, green, and blue, very basic colors. But if you wanted your Neopet to look really fancy and exotic, you had to use these things called paintbrushes. Now, paintbrushes weren't free. And again, this is the reason why they were so coveted. The only way you could get these paintbrushes is if you did these really hard challenges, or if you found a user on the website that was trading these paintbrushes for money, for Neo points, excuse me. So remember, I can't go onto Neopets and spend American dollars to get a paintbrush, but I can trade somebody my Neo points to get a paintbrush. So remember, that's the non-fungible aspect about what I'm talking about. So NFT, non-fungible, the F stands for fungible. Non-fungible means I can't go on this website, pay money, and get my thing. I have to go on, get Neo points, which means something completely different, trade those Neo points for this item to then use the item on my digital thing. And even still, if I had this paintbrush, I couldn't trade it for basically. Look up non-fungible, is what I'm telling you. Okay, for the pure definition of non-fungible. But my point is, you get to these paintbrushes, and there are harder ones to get. So I think rainbow is really hard to get. Anything that looks kind of like these plushy ones, these Darragon and all these other ones, these were worth 2 million Neo points because they were so hard to get and the supply was so low. So their value was really high because people wanted their pet to look like an Egyptian, but it cost you 5 million Neo points to get it. Whereas these smaller paintbrushes like red, blue, and green, they were so common that those might have been 1,000 neo points. And so what I'm showing you is that different items have different values. And it's the same thing with CryptoPunks or any kind of NFT. It's a digital good, a digital asset, but you're using this digital currency, neo points, to buy it. Okay? And that's the same exact thing that's what's happening right now. And this is, if you play Neopets, you will understand NFTs because it's the same thing. And so in the game, if you collect one of these hard to get paintbrushes, you don't necessarily have to use it on your pet. You could actually collect it. You don't have to use it. You can just collect it. So the equivalent would be to say, okay, this is a CryptoPunk. I don't have to use it. I just have to collect it because I can trade it again. Yeah, we're all in a virtual world. So let's say my mission on Neopets was to capture all these plushy paintbrushes. Let's say I have 20 of them and only have 4 pets. So technically, if I wanted to use them, I couldn't. And so I have 15 extra brushes, or however, whatever the math I just did was. 15 extra brushes. I can't use them. I'm collecting them. But the cool part is that other people want them. So now I can buy this paintbrush at 2 million. And since I have a limited supply, the next person who really, really wants it is willing to pay 2.5 million for it. And so I trade them and I take the profit of $500,000. So the same thing is happening with NFTs. You can buy them right now, for example, $1,000. I'm just making up a number. And then somebody who really wants it, even though they're not going to use it, they just want to collect it. They really want it because they know somebody else is going to want it. Okay. Is that I buy it for $1,000, somebody else wants it for $10,000. Okay. And so you make a profit that way. So that's what people are doing in the NFT world. Now, there's a lot more to it, like smart contracts and royalties and all this type of stuff. That's a little more advanced because it gets into a lot and I don't want to get into that. Let me see what else is in Neopets. So all these different stores, Neopets is like a perfect explanation of this. So if you guys feel adventurous, go to neopets.com. I don't even know if it's still loaded up. And just figure it out. Because all these different stores are like NFT marketplaces. So remember, these paintbrushes are an item in the game that I can only buy with the game's currency. Okay, so the equivalent, if I had to make an equivalent, the game's currency in the digital world is called Ethereum, for example, ETH. So if I wanted to buy an NFT currently, I would have to spend ETH, which is what, let me go to most, but they're listed in Ethereum. So it's not listed in dollars. It's listed in either WETH, which stands for wrapped Ethereum, or it's in ETH. You don't need to understand what WETH is. That's why I didn't want to get too complicated. The point is you can't just straight up buy this with cash. Now, some places you can, but the point is you want to use this digital currency called Ethereum. Okay, so the same thing as Neopoints. Okay, so it does have value because you could trade it for something else. All right. And that's what it is if I had to make a parallel between NFTs online and Neopets, because you're using a digital currency to buy a digital good. All right, so let's scroll on down. So as you're buying these digital goods on Neopets, you can buy them in multiple places. So you can buy them in the food store, you can buy them in the hospital, you can buy them at the pet shop. Okay, these are all places where you can purchase different items. So for example, if I wanted a paintbrush, I wouldn't go to the food shop to buy a paintbrush. That's not where they sell paintbrushes. Okay, so you're gonna hear about these places called NFT marketplaces. Shout out to everybody who's in here. You're gonna hear about these places called NFT marketplaces. And NFT marketplaces are just different places to buy different things. Because again, it's not gonna be one shop that sells everything online. That's just not how humans work. We love to segment and kind of separate. So again, you wouldn't go to a pet store to buy a hamburger, and you wouldn't go to the food shop to buy a paintbrush. So the same thing is happening online right now. We just have these different places called like Rarible. Another one's called OpenSea, S-E-A. That's another place you'll hear. What's another NFT marketplace? Let's just type in NFT marketplace. So again, look at it like collecting these hard to get items. Now, every item on Neopets is not valuable. Remember, it goes back to supply and demand. So let me see if they have a picture of the other items in Neopets. I don't think they do. But in Neopets, you have certain items that are just every or just common. I'm trying to see if they have a picture of it here. Like, for example, this is a great picture. So these things that the characters are holding are common items. They only cost about 10 Neo points, which is like nothing. Whereas this paintbrush that you could win if you kind of line up the things in the game, you could win this fairy paintbrush, which is like 25,000 in the game. So there's certain items that are worth 10 because, again, supply and demand. The supply is so high, but nobody wants it. So the demand is low. So the price is low. Whereas this paintbrush, the supply is low, meaning there aren't that many of them, and a lot of people want them. So the price goes up. And so what I'm saying is that every NFT is not valued the same, simply based on supply and demand and based on what people actually want to buy. And the people who make people want to buy stuff are curators. The same way online, if I'm making a video about Isotope plugins, you might want to buy it more because you're like, wow, he made the Isotope plugin sound super dope. I want it now. So curators are the same type of person in the NFT world. They kind of tell people what's cool to buy. Whereas all the millions of people making random NFTs, there's no real demand for it. So the price is going to stay low. And so I'm trying to give you an equivalent here about NFT marketplaces. So again, you can't buy a paintbrush at a burger shop, and you're not going to buy a burger at a pet shop. Okay, so you're going to buy them in different places. So NFT marketplaces are changing. So you have something like OpenSea, which is one. Where are the other ones? That's weird that these are ranking high for this keyword. But you have Origin, NFT Marketplace. It's called Known Origin. So there are all these different places where you can buy different items. And in Neopets, the cool part about the shops, and this has taught me everything about everything. In Neopets, if we go back to the shops, you could go into the shop and it would have a dynamic inventory of stuff. So for example, you spent most of the time here. If you were trying to make money in the game, your goal was to buy something at a low price and sell it for a high price. Because what you're actually buying is that people couldn't buy it fast enough. So for example, in these stores, you would try to refresh your web browser as fast as you could because it's dynamic. So like everything in the store would change based on the timing, and they would refresh the inventory in the store every, let's say, 2 hours or so. So you would come back to the stores to find these rare items, and you would keep hitting refresh until you saw them refresh their inventory. And if you were lucky enough, you could buy something before it was sold out. Okay, so you could buy like a rare paintbrush for a very low price, let's say $100. And then the paintbrush itself was worth $2 million. But in order to get it, you had to be really fast in these stores. So the same thing happens in NFT world, is that you can have these super dope NFT drops, they're called, or super dope digital art pieces drop. But if you're not fast enough, then you're not going to be able to buy it if you wanted to. And the only way to buy it is to buy it off of somebody who has it for sale. And that's where they get to make whatever price they want. So again, there's a lot of mirrors to Neopets. If you guys have ever played Neopets, there's a lot of a lot of this stuff. I don't know the artist on this website, but there might be certain items that people who are playing this kind of virtual game in their mind, they know are going to be super hot items. And that's why a lot of people follow the NFT artist on Twitter, because they will be like, okay guys, I'm about to drop this new whatever collection. And so people are ready. It's the same thing as these stores on Neopets about to refresh their inventory. They're going, hey guys, we refresh the inventory every 2 hours. This is your chance to get something that's worth $2 million for $100. And everybody's waiting and waiting and waiting to get in their store so they can go buy the NFTs. And if you're not fast enough, you're not going to be able to buy it. So going back to a place like Known Origin, in order to know what's even popular, you have to start following the culture of NFTs and different things. And that's where you go into people's Discords and follow them on Twitter and all types of stuff. That's how you understand the value, to know that this thing is not worth the same thing as this thing over here, or why people might like this thing in the middle as opposed to not liking anything else. Okay, so it's more than just what it visually looks like. It's actually based on what people value as a whole. Okay, so that's what NFTs are. Now, the cool part about music is that you can combine this digital stuff with music, and you could sell it that way. And you can get splits based on how you set up your collaboration with the NFT artist. So you can have, you know, let's say 10% of the purchase price go to the musician. So it's a really cool way to collab with these people called NFT artists. Okay, so that is what it's all about for music people. Now you can also just do just music, but that's a little bit different because we have to create that established value around having that one song by the one artist. Okay, the same way we have to get hype about these CryptoPunk drops, you have to create hype around the drop of whatever song or whatever you're doing. So again, I didn't get into one main aspect of this all, which is that the power of NFTs is actually in ownership. Hold on one sec. My guy's asking me a question. Now, everybody must be in New York. I'm not in New York currently. If anybody's wondering, I made an Instagram post. I was there a couple days ago, but I'm not there anymore. I think people, I didn't realize how many business people were in New York. Let me see something. Hold on. I'm getting distracted. Oh, let me see. Okay, Deuce says, Busy, hear me out, man. First off, love your videos. Doge is Elon's rocket. He's launching quarter one 2020. Oh, he's launching a rocket called Doge. Wow. It's completely backed by Doge. Wow. The hype will make it explode. It has been falling. I've never heard of that. So you have, I don't want to get into the weeds about everything because you have different currencies like Dogecoin and all this type of stuff. Now, there's a long explanation about which currencies are legit and which ones aren't. Basically, Dogecoin doesn't have a utility. It's just based on hype, which is fine if you understand that. You're betting. People are betting. But things like Ethereum, where people are building real projects and real utility and real software and real apps and everything, that's why it's going up in value so much. But I'm not an investor, so I don't know everything about every protocol. Enter.audio is best new music marketplace. Enter audio. Yeah, there's a lot of them. There's a place called Audius. That's a place. What is this here? Enter is currently being updated. Okay. Featured NFTs. So here are our music NFTs. If we're getting into music NFTs. Now, I think the way they're doing the music NFTs is not the way it should be done. Because again, if you've ever played Neopets, you understand how people view items, like if that makes sense. So in Neopets, again, if for those who haven't played the game, forgive me, but this is the only reference I have in my head. So in Neopets, you had, you know, items. Let me see if I could Google Neopets items. We need like a list or something like that. Perfect. Okay, somebody has a whole website dedicated to this. How hilarious. So in Neopets, you have items that can be used, but people just don't use them. So here's an item, a collectible robe you can put on your Neopet to wear. So there's usable things. It's just that people collect them and they don't necessarily use them. So there's a secondary reinforcement to utility. Whereas if we're talking about audio NFTs, the question becomes, what's the use case for it? Like, are people trying to just make a song over it? Or are they trying to own the copyrights and the publishing behind it? Like, what are we trading exactly? Because technically people could record this, download the music and have it. But that's not what people are trying to own with audio. They're trying to own ownership. And this is the hard part to really understand about NFTs. 2021 hype is legit. Yeah, I'm going to read the questions in 2 seconds because y'all writing like paragraphs, so it's really hard to read fastly. But I'm going to read your stuff in 3 seconds right after I make this point. Uh-oh, my bit rate, it says. Bit rate is low. Hold on one sec, y'all. So, okay, my bad, I had to read something. So, what was I talking about? Items, there's certain utility to certain items. Oh, music NFTs. So the way they're presented right now, I feel like people don't understand what they're actually buying. They're like, can I just buy this off your website? Why do I have to buy it with my crypto wallet? And the point is that with crypto on the blockchain, you can prove that you own something. So why is that important that we can prove stuff? The importance of proving stuff and ownership is because you can prove that you have the authentic asset. And it's, again, it's hard to understand an asset until you've ever played Neopets. That's hilarious. until you played Neopets. So, trying to make this make sense, you need a visual to really understand this. But let me just start with the blockchain. So the blockchain is basically a thing that was created to make it to where if people ever change something and it didn't agree with the whole consensus or the whole combined computer network. In other words, if you've ever played Whisper Down the Lane, and you know that when you say, I got a new dog in the first kid's ear, and then the second kid tells the third kid, on and on and on and on and on. And then the message comes back to you and it's like, my dog Sally has red hair. You're like, that's not what I said. I said, I got a new dog. That's what I said. So that currently in our current reality, that's exactly what happens. Our communication, our messages get distorted because of people's ill intent, because of bots, because of all types of stuff. So I could say, I got a new dog. And then, oh, what's up? What's going on, Courtney? So I can say, I got a new dog. And our current reality, somebody will manipulate and twist and distort that message. So again, it comes back in my other ear. My dog Sally has red hair. And that's not what I said. But on the blockchain, they have it to where I can send a message or a signal and it will come back the same exact way. So if I go, I have a new dog. And then the message keeps going around and around and around. And then somebody distorts the message and says, my dog Sally is my new dog or whatever. We can find the point where it got distorted and match it back with the original message to say, is this authentically coming from that person? And is that what they tried to say? And the answer will be no. And the network or the group of people that were sharing that message will decline the change. So what it means is that you can't change what goes in. Okay, you cannot change what goes into the blockchain. It's called immutable. It means it cannot be changed or distorted or manipulated by other people. So that's the importance of the blockchain. Think of like Whisper Down the Lane. That's the easiest thing to understand when it comes to what the blockchain does. So it prevents your message from being messed up coming back to you. That's what the blockchain does. Now, the reason that's important for music is because now if we try to own something, we can prove that we own that thing and it will never change. And so we can do this by what's called verification. You can verify using that same type of Whisper Down the Lane technology to verify that Todd owns the song Rain Dance. So Todd is entitled to X, Y, and Z, or Todd, or the fact that Todd owns it. Maybe it's a super popular Wu-Tang song, for example. Todd can be like, yo, I own the authentic Wu-Tang cream, cashews, everything around me. I own that. The music itself is art. It just doesn't have a visual to it, but it is art. It's culturally valuable. Cream is like, cash rules everything around me. Cream, get the money. Dollar, dollar bill, y'all. I mean, that's like, it's in everybody's psyche in hip hop for the most part. So it has value. It's just that the problem with the current system is that everybody could own Cream. Technically own it, even though we don't own the record. You are buying a copy of it. You are owning the original masters. So now we can go into, you know, a site like, you know, one of these sites. This is a random site. But, and then now you can see who actually owns Cream, the song. And they could display it just like they display their art on the walls. It's all digital. So that's the cool part about NFTs and what it means. I know it's hard to understand, but until you get into the digital worlds, like a CryptoVoxels, for example, or Decentraland is another one. Decentraland, I think I'm spelling this right. I don't even know if it's CryptoVoxels.com. It might be like .io or something. CryptoVoxels. You said, but what is the main con regarding the blockchain? The main, oh, it is .com. So the main thing about I'm going to go back in reverse and answer some stuff because you guys are probably smarter than me on most of this. The main concern with the blockchain is that there are these things called, what do they call it? Hard wallets and soft wallets. Let's just say a crypto wallet. Let's call it a crypto wallet. So what the, I didn't get into what this also means. Before I even get into crypto wallets, let me explain one thing I forgot. So with music, the current technology that we're working with, this whole crypto NFT stuff, will cut out so many middlemen, including lawyers and including accountants and including managers and all types of people in the traditional music industry. Because let me see, where's that picture? Music industry, artist, 13%. I forget what that chart. But artists and producers only make about 13% of everything that they put out. They only make about 13 to 16%. So then somebody has the chart. Let me go to images. POAP, so people watching the stream can mint NFTs that they say they were here. Oh, I never even heard of that before. POAP. It's interesting. But the question is, even if they can mint that, is that valuable to anybody? That's the question that everybody's asking. But the cool part about what Nicholas is saying is that with proof of attending, I'm assuming that's what POA stands for, you can prove that you have attended something. So let's say you guys came to my mastermind seminars. You can now have it to where you can prove using the blockchain that you were actually there based on like geolocation, whatever. I forget how they described it, but you can prove that you were actually there with this thing called an NFT or an NFT. And then you could be rewarded for actually proving to me that you showed up without using anything physical like a lanyard or something like that. So that's the cool part about all this. And let me see here. Where is the chart? Who in the world has the chart? Let me see if I can find it. If I can't find it, darn, wait, I'm trying to think of the headline. It was like, musicians only make 13%, something like this. I'm gonna find it. I know I'm gonna find it. Let's forget who put it out. Follow the money. Why musicians only, darn, it was such a big, I think it was The Verge. I wanna say it was The Verge did the article. Let's pray it's this one. If it's not this one, then it is what it is. The Verge. No, they did this article. Whatever. So there's a picture floating around that showed that only 13% of your royalties and all this, there's royalties, go to artists. If I don't find this chart, it's gonna drive me insane. You know how you hear a sample song and you can't remember the sample song until you stumble across it? That's just gonna drive me nuts until I find it. I think it's somewhere. Is it, wait, it might be this site. I think we're onto something. No, but it looks similar to this chart. It was kind of like this one, an infographic. Maybe it was by SongTrust, who knows. So anyway, I'm not gonna waste your time looking up the actual file, but basically, you make 100% of the song and you only get 13% of the money from it, whereas the other 80% goes to the publishing and all types of people involved. So crypto and NFTs are going to give you that other 80% that was being taken from you back to you, because now you don't have to use these places to administer, or I shouldn't say administer, but you don't have to use these places to then manage your stuff or pay you. So currently, I wish there was a whiteboard technology we could use. There might be a free whiteboard online. But that's the, to answer your question, I just realized I want a long drawn out explanation, Loner Square. So let me answer your question directly, and I'm gonna look up something called online draw pad or something like this. Sketch. Is this free? All right, Sketch. All right, looks free. Okay, so currently the way the music business is set up is like this. So you as a producer, all right, bear with my spelling here. You make a song. Okay, you make something. Let's say a song. You get it placed, okay? Now, in order to get paid from this, let me go back. In order to get paid from this song, I'm gonna draw a really long line. Let's say it takes around 9 months to get paid for this song. And we're not talking about advances or people paying you for the service of your time. We're talking about the back end of this all. It's going to take you 9 months to get paid, because the 9 months you have to, the song has to go through all these entities, like a PRO firstly. Then you have to go through Harry Fox. Then you have to go through, what are the other ones out there? I'm forgetting all the names. Let's just say Song Trust. I'm just making up stuff. Then you have to wait on reports and accounting from all these businesses and all this type of stuff. So you have all this stuff that takes an extremely long amount of time. It could take around 9 months to get paid for a record you did. So the problem is you have 9 months of bills. So you're negative 9 months in bill money. Okay, now you could have a hit song, but you don't get paid for 9 months. I've heard 2 years sometimes. Okay, so 9 months you're waiting with negative money. So this is the current position we're in for the traditional music industry. And the reason we're in this position is because all these in-between companies purposely, I think, add all this time to the equation to suffocate you as a producer and a songwriter, because they know if you can't pay your bills for 9 months that you're more likely to take their crappy deals. Okay, so again, you're down negative 9 months worth of bills. So a producer who's dope, they have these people called publishers come through, and on top of lawyers working for the labels and all types of stuff, like a lot of crazy stuff happening behind the scenes, like you think you're getting an honest lawyer, you think he has your best interest, but in reality he works for a label. I've heard of a lot of those stories. And they come to you and they're like, we'll give you, let's say 2 million, let's 2 million is kind of, let's do something more simple. Let's say we'll give you 100,000. Okay, so you're like, wow, $100,000 cash that the publisher gave me, because again, you're not gonna have that income for 9 months. So what are you gonna do for 9 months as your song's growing its revenues in the current systems? There's no way to get paid from that back end money outside, because you don't control these systems. They tell you when you get paid, you don't tell them when you get paid. Okay, so the publishers and different companies come to you and they say, hey, here's $100,000. We'll pay you for the time basically that you can't make money, but we want our money back plus some. Okay, so it's, they force you into a position to where you have to take this loan, and then you owe not only the loan back, the $100,000, but you own, let's say, I'm making up numbers because I don't know every single deal, let's just say you own 20%, you owe, excuse me, plus 20% on the $120,000. So really you don't owe $100,000, you owe $120,000 by the term of this loan, all because these systems forced you to take all this time to get paid. And that's where a lot of people are in the music industry right now. They take these crappy deals because they have to wait so long to get paid. And so what this technology is going to do is free people up from this element, the time element. So now when your song gets played and all these royalties and different things, you'll actually get credited immediately for the song purchase, for the song being played, for all the back end stuff. So that's the cool part about this system. It's freeing people from these slave things. It's freeing you from the manipulation of the music industry. This is the biggest thing that it's solving for in music, is just lowering the time, which gets rid of all these middlemen right here. Now, not all of them, but it gets rid of a lot of people. So if you don't understand what an NFT is, I described it a little bit earlier, so you could rewind to see the full kind of definition for it. Yeah, so a lot of people don't have the financial awareness to learn how to pay loans off and leverage debt and all these things. So the majority of people are just being suckered into these debt deals that they can't even pay back. So that's the manipulation in the current music industry. But what NFTs are going to solve for are, again, this time factor that we're worried about in music of getting paid. Now, there's other reasons why you would get into NFTs and all this, but it's so much to explain that I don't want to lose people talking about DeFi and all this type of stuff. Did my stream crash? Hold on. Make sure it's all good. Is my thing tripping? Sometimes I start using keywords and it starts to act weird. All right, we have 6 people in here. Thank you for joining. Let me triple check. I just gave all that game for nobody. Whatever it is, what it is. Okay, so going back, is this. So you asked, what are the cons of the blockchain? So the cons of the blockchain are the crypto wallets. In short, people who have to use these wallets, since we got rid of so many middlemen, we don't need bank institutions even. If I could send you directly Loaner Squared $100 using my crypto wallet, I don't need a bank. I don't need anything. It goes straight to you. Similar to Cash App, but Cash App requires middlemen. But just imagine me, Cash App, you. But you don't even need Cash App in this case. I could just send stuff directly to your, what's called your crypto address, and then you can receive it. Similar to Cash App, but without Cash App, if that makes sense. Marcus Miller says, thanks a lot for the knowledge. Thank you for your Canadian $5 that I will convert into USD. Thank you. Appreciate you. And so I'm saying all this to say that it's a lot more responsibility for people who own their own bank, basically. So the reason we use banks is because of security features, like your money's insured if anything were to happen, or your bank can always help you log back into their website if you forgot your password. But with crypto, if you lose what's called a seed phrase, you literally won't have access to your money forever. Nobody will have access to your money. So there's no backup plan. So that type of responsibility is a little, not alarming, but it's a little worrying, because I know the average American is not going to remember their seed phrases and all types of stuff. But it gives you full control over your assets without using these middlemen called banks and different institutions like that. So that's the one con I could see for cryptocurrency, because it's a little complicated to learn how to even use your crypto wallet. And on top of that, people who are ignorant could accidentally leak their crypto wallet phrase or their crypto wallet address, and now they have hackers trying to log into their crypto wallet to steal all this stuff. So I could see the cons for sure, but the positives greatly outweigh the work going into it. No, I'm not going to delete the stream. Let me start just engaging with you real quick. That's why you need POAP. Early on your Noah's Ark, hilarious. I'm going to look into that, POAP. Never heard of that before. Stream ended randomly. See, I'm using keywords that trigger the you-know-whos. Because even the platform that we're on right now, it's a centralized platform. We have to come here to commune. Whereas the future crypto stuff is decentralized, which means that no one company could tell us how to communicate. We decide how we want to communicate. It's decentralized. There's no one place we come to do anything. And that's the future, hopefully, of cryptocurrency. Please save the video. Sorry that the thing crashed. I'm not sure why. I mean, I have theory why, but I don't know why. Yeah, if you don't understand what NFT is, just rewind a little bit. Spooter said, we still need to find an actual use case for it. The thing is, how are artists going to get paid for their art if the content is free? How can you monetize art for the masses? The same way Pokemon cards are monetized. Your question might be going a little bit deeper, but I like to always simplify stuff to say, why do we value Pokemon cards? It's the story around Pokemon. Because Pokemon could just print cards and call them collectibles and call it a day. But what people truly want is that, is the story behind Pokemon is what made it popular. I didn't mean to yawn in the mic, sorry. So Pokemon also came with a TV show, and that TV show made the trading cards more popular because there was a story around the artwork. And so your question is, if people could download, let's say, an NFT for free by just copying the picture, like I could go to, Google, type in CryptoPunk, download it to my desktop and call it a day. But the difference is that the moment I get on the blockchain using my what's called your crypto wallet, I can't prove that I own this CryptoPunk, which means I technically don't have it in the digital crypto wallet world. You can't show that you actually own it. The same way we could have physical art in a museum like the Mona Lisa, which is worth, let's look up the Mona Lisa price. Mona Lisa price, one of the most talked about pieces of art ever. It's worth more than $850 million. Okay, but think about how many Mona Lisa paintings you've seen in Target or in on the corner somewhere. You've seen a gazillion of them. But the difference is that they don't own the original Mona Lisa. They can't prove that they own the original. Even if somebody went out their way to act like they paint, like they got the material paper that feels like a painting and sprayed that old smell on it and tried to convince their friends that it was the real authentic Mona Lisa, technically, if they had the art scientists come by and do the little paint scraping tests and all that type of stuff that they do, they could prove that it's not the real Mona Lisa. And so we could do this a lot easier online to prove something's real without pulling out the tools to test the paint, to test the lighting and all this. We could prove something's real and you're the true owner digitally, which doesn't take as much time. So it's the same thing with online digital assets. We're just proving it digitally as opposed to pulling out our toolkit and try to do a paint test and a litmus test and all this type of stuff. So that's what it is. Now, earlier I talked about how the current supply of music is almost infinite because anybody can have it. But with the new world, you can create digital scarcity, which means that I can put out only 10 copies of something or only 100 copies of something. That's, and it's legitimate because it lives on the blockchain and there can be no more than those 100 copies. That's the cool part with music, any digital asset. But not only that, it's that people can prove that they own it. That's the most important thing. Because that ownership can be your key into different things, like different digital assets. Like, for example, if I had a virtual world where I had a virtual house, and the only way to get into the virtual house is to own an NFT. Let's say I drop like 10 NFTs. And the only way to get in the virtual house is on the blockchain. You have to show me your NFT to get in. And the people who don't own the NFT, basically the people who just right-clicked and saved the picture, the people who don't actually own the NFT can never get into that virtual home, for example. And so you could use it like a lock and key system as well. There's a lot of things you could do with NFTs, but that's just a couple concepts around it. And again, I'm speaking on such a novice level. As I'm speaking to you, I'm realizing how much I actually don't have a grasp on this entire market, which is a little crazy to think. But what is the main... Oh, I see that already. What are your thoughts? It's 2020. There's also Rocket.app. Rocky app music. Did I spell that right? Rocky. Oh, I spelled rock. My bad. Rocky app. Okay, here we go. I think all these projects, the problem with these projects is that they don't have the culture behind it. I don't know any of these people. No idea who these people are. So there's a lot of tech people who are doing projects, but the problem is they don't have the cool kids on their side. So regardless of who, like this says Binance Smart Chain. So somebody built, here's another thing I forgot to mention, which is kind of beyond the point of the video. But the, where were we at? Coin market cap. So again, the easiest way to get into crypto, just for those who just hop back in, is just go to coinbase.com and go to coinmarketcap.com. And just put your money slowly into these different things. You'll start to slowly understand what all this is. It's a very big, broad science. It's very huge. Whoops. How do we go back? Okay. So what was I getting at? So Rocky app said it was built on the Binance Smart Chain. So for example, if I go to coinmarketcap.com, again, remember the market cap basically describes how much confidence people have in a given cryptocurrency. So Bitcoin right now is leading. It has $900 billion worth of market cap, which means people believe it that much, that they're taking it up to almost $1 trillion, which is the same confidence as Apple. Let's see, Apple market cap. I don't even know if that's the same terminology. Market cap, 2.6, 2.3 trillion is Apple. So if I had to make a comparison, people believe in Bitcoin about half as much as they do in Apple currently. So that's the way you can kind of measure people's belief. They believe in Bitcoin about half as they do in Apple. So imagine how authoritative Apple is in the world. People believe in Bitcoin almost that much. So that's what that tells me, the market cap. Now, Binance Coin is the one, two, three, the fourth one on this list. So it's valued, I mean, the market cap is at $73 billion. Which means people believe it that much. And what I'm saying is that these are all different things you can potentially build on top of. So I don't know the whole chain of, actually, let me see if I can look it up. Crypto layers. Let me see if I can find a picture of it. Here it is, I think. So if we look at this picture, this looks super complicated. But all it's saying is that, and I'll make a comparison in a second. I'm just trying to find a better picture. Let me see. Crypto app layers, maybe. Where's it at? I saw one with like Uniswap. I'm trying to find it. Let me see. If I don't find it in the next search, it is what it is. Okay, this is not it. This is definitely not it. Okay, anyway, so on the picture here, this looks convoluted, but all this is showing is that stuff's built on top of other stuff. That's basically, I think my head's in the way. So this might be, let's open it up in a new tab. Is my head in the way? Let me see. Kind of in the way. It is what it is. So I'm blocking the corner. I'm barely blocking it. All right. So going back to this, think of it like an operating system. That's the easiest thing for me to understand with this stuff. So the bottom, this is like having Windows 10, okay? And then all this stuff on top is like having FL Studio. What else comes with Windows? I don't even know. Word, Microsoft Word, blah, 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 blah. So Ethereum in this case is an operating system. It actually is a virtual computer. Ethereum Virtual Machine, EVM, Ethereum Virtual Machine. So it's a virtual computer, aka an operating system, that has apps built on top of a virtual thing. So imagine your whole computer that you're running right now on a virtual thing. Kind of like imagine your DAW that you work out of right now, and then imagine your DAW on the internet, where you can make beats on the internet. That would sound crazy. I'm sure there are DAWs on the internet, but it's the same thing with Ethereum. So Ethereum is the bottom layer, they call it. And you could build these apps on top of the operating system. The same way I can have an iPhone and I could have all these apps like Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, blah, 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 on and on and on. So Ethereum in this case would be the iPhone or the iOS technically, iOS. And then all the stuff on top of it would be the apps. And I'm saying all this to say that based on the different apps, people build different projects with the different apps. So this website called, where was it at? The website that we went to called, where is it at? Rocky.app. It says it was built on the Binance Smart Chain. And so it was built on top of an operating system or an app built with a certain app. So that's what they're describing when they say built on the Binance Smart Chain. So depending on which operating system people place their apps on, that's what increases the value of these apps. So that's what I said. There's a lot of tech companies making apps, but they don't necessarily have the cool kid factor to the apps. It's kind of like people making a bunch of video games, but nobody plays the video game. So it does, like if you go on Xbox Live and nobody's playing the video game, you don't want to play it anymore because nobody's playing it online. So you're like, why play this game online when nobody's playing it? So the same thing happens with these apps and different things. All right. And that's the most simplified layman's way I could put it. There's a gazillion pieces of tech behind what I just said. And don't get me to making stuff up because I will. All right. So let's see what else we got over here. What else did I go over? All right. Let me see what else we got. Neopets. We went through this. I'm going to answer your question in 3 seconds. Let's X out of half this stuff. So all these marketplaces with like random stuff. All these marketplaces with like random stuff. What was I even saying? I don't even know what I was saying. Let me shut up. Oh, that's what I was saying. So all these marketplaces with the random music in it, I don't think they're going to really take off unless they get the people behind it. You have to have the people behind all this stuff. At the end of the day, I can make the dopest boat, but if nobody's going to ride the boat, it doesn't have a purpose except being a boat. That's probably a bad example, but hopefully you get me. So let's do a Q&A. My brain is on max. Marcus says, for the market cap, do you know how believing in something can end up with a precise number? That's what you don't get. So basically, you're talking about like price discovery, I think is what you're referring to. So at the end of the day, something that helps me simplify all this stuff is that people only pay what they're willing to pay. Like, you've probably gone somewhere where you paid a price, but you're like, okay, I would have paid $50 for that. Like, somebody charges you $5 for a slice of cake, but you're like, that cake was so good, I would have paid $20 for that slice. So in your head, you're thinking, I would have paid 20. In the seller's head, they're like, I'm selling it to you for $5. But you were willing to go up to 20. So that's price discovery, is trying to figure out that magical price that's in everybody's mind, a consensus price. You know, you and the next person behind me may come in the store and they say, that piece of cake was, I don't care how tasty it is, I'm only going to pay $3 for a piece of cake, because I pay $1 for water, so $3 for. So they, in their head, they have a limit as to how high the price of cake in general should be. So they're like, they will never pay over $3. So when the seller comes in and they say, you could buy this cake for $5, that customer goes, $5? I'm only going to pay $3 max for cake. That's it. And then they don't buy the cake. Whereas the person before, they're like, wow, I would have spent $20. This thing was so good. And so you have two different price points. So the what we're trying to find with anything is what people are willing to agree upon. So those two customers, one's willing to pay $3 and the other one's willing to pay $20. They both agree that they're willing to pay $3 at maximum. They're both willing to do that. So that's where the true value of something is. And that's why stocks go down. You're probably like, how do stocks go down? It's because the hype makes people feel like they're adding excess value to something. So there are the people that come in like, oh my God, I would have paid $20 for this piece of cake. And you have enough customers like that, you're like, okay, well, I'm gonna sell my cake for $20, until you get to the everybody else who's only willing to pay $3 for the cake. And then the price of the stock goes down in that case, or the whatever you're investing in goes down, because you need to match the supply with the demand. And again, if people are telling you they're only gonna buy something at $3 max, that's what they're gonna buy it for, period. And so that's the realization of the market when the bubbles burst, so to speak. You go back to the real price, not the overhyped price. And so that's why stuff goes down in the market. So for me, to help me understand it, is just understanding that the only way stuff is bought is because you have a buyer and a seller. And the only way stuff moves, I should say, is when people buy it. When there's a buyer for the price you have to sell. I could sell my Bitcoin for $60,000, but if the market's like, I'm not buying your listed Bitcoin at $60,000, like, why would I spend $12,000 more dollars than I have to? So that's what price discovery is all about. And that's why our dollar is so convoluted, because the supply keeps changing. So now it's harder to find where the dollar is actually at. But I'm not an economist, so I don't know. Hello, Busy. Are we going to listen to music today? That was yesterday, not today. Thank you. Yeah, we have something big coming in. It's just, I didn't realize like how much people are going to have to get educated on this stuff before they even step foot into things like Coinbase. So I didn't even get into like the surface level stuff yet. But I told you about NFTs. I told you about crypto. So as far as actionable steps, if you guys are really interested in just learning the general basics of crypto, just go to Coinbase and start there. I know technically you're not owning your crypto, but it's just an easy way to start to put your toe in the field. So as a person who was from the outside coming in, this is the one thing that helped me understand it a little bit better. So Coinbase is, you can buy those basic kind of digital currencies, Bitcoin, Ethereum, Cardano, those basic ones. There are cryptocurrencies you can't buy on these exchanges though. So there's that as well. And so here it looks like I'm logged in, but you can, this is like Coinbase Pro. Now, I don't know how to read charts and all this type of stuff. Trizza could probably teach me a little bit more. But basically here's the left side is what they're selling, I think. And then the right side is what they're buying. So you can see they're selling it for $7,000, but they're only buying it for $5,900. Am I reading that right? I'm probably way off. I don't know how to read charts. That may or may not be the right case. Let me go to a cryptocurrency I know. Let's go to Ethereum. So Ethereum is listed at 34, but that's usually an average. So people are buying it. Oh, it looks like I was way wrong. Oh, people are buying it at 35.04 and they're selling it at 33.76. So, which means the demand is higher than the supply, it looks like. So the demand is outweighing. They're willing to pay up to 3,500 to buy some Ethereum, but the sellers are selling it low. So they're trying to get it off. They're trying to sell to the people. But if the left side were higher than the right side, then that means the stock's coming down. If I'm reading this right, I mean, it looks pretty basic. The price on the pretty basic. The price on the left says sell. The price on the right says buy. So I'm assuming here that people are selling it for 33.75 on average, and then you have people buying it for a higher price, which means you have more buyers than you have sellers, which means the sellers are doing good on this one. And you may ask why people would ever sell a stock that's going up. If there's so many buyers, why sell a stock? Some people want cash in hand. Some people use debt to buy crypto and buy assets. So they have to take the money out to then pay off the debt. There's different reasons why people may take profit and exit a market. So there's all different reasons. Hopefully I didn't make that up. It seems right, what I just said. It seems right, but don't take that for gospel. But it's the basic principle of buy low, sell high. He was so small, let me see. Wait, what am I looking at? Give me a second, y'all. She is a cat that was so tiny at the time. We could do a Q&A, but I mean, I'm not a genius when it comes to all this type of stuff. My bet. My girl tends to come first before you guys, and that will always be the case. What do you think about Unison MidiCorp pack? I think Unison leveraged all the influencers, and the influencers just gave their likeness away for pennies probably, and made Unison millions of dollars probably. Just giving away culture. That's a perfect example, bringing us full circle, is that these tech companies can make any product they want, but what makes the product cool and makes it sell is the cool kids behind it, like Unison MidiCorp pack. Who was talking about Unison MidiCorp pack before they saw Sharp and all the kids on Unison? I think Chuki was on there maybe. Don't get me to quoting the wrong people. But the point is, nobody was really paying attention like that until they saw the key people that were in our community on those commercials and different things. So they could have the tech all day, but without the people, the tech doesn't matter. And that's the same exact thing that's what's happening with certain projects on the in the crypto world. You have all this tech, but they don't have the right cool people behind it to make it important, even though it could be the world-changing tech. The same way you can make the dopest beat, but if nobody hears it, or if you can't get people on it, it doesn't really matter. You are definitely taking us places. Oh, thank you. For the market cap, do you know, how is the process of making, uploading NFTs? Is it similar to platforms like YouTube? Basically, I don't know where you can mint for a low price. I'm really trying to think. Let's say NFT minting. So there are different places you can mint. I'm trying to see one that's affordable. Basically, let me see. Mintable's one. Let's just go to Mintable, for example. You can come on Mintable. There's also Mintbase. That's another one. Mintbase.io. So it's Mintbase, Mintable. You can come here and then you deploy your store, it's called, or create your store. And then, so without getting into the weeds about everything, you have to, this is where it gets convoluted. So every site requires, it's like an email address. This is something I forgot to go over, is the crypto wallet. So your crypto address is similar to an email address, kind of, in a way. So when you go to different websites, it'll ask you to log in with your crypto wallet. And that crypto wallet is the equivalent, in my understanding, of like an email address, some type of identity that's specific and personable to you. So you come to these websites, you log in with your crypto wallet, and then from that crypto wallet, you can start minting NFTs. Okay, so right here it says start minting. But the problem is, see how it says the NFT is already in my wallet? Okay, let's just create a new item. And it's probably gonna tell me to link my wallet at some point. Traditional or gasless? So this is where it gets convoluted and I didn't wanna go down this path. But basically, whenever you try to do anything on the blockchain, it costs resources. And those resources are called gas fees. So it's similar to tax. You can't really buy anything in America without paying some type of tax. So the same thing's online. In order to create something using the blockchain, you have to pay like a, I'm saying tax, but technically it's not tax. It's called a gas fee. Okay, you have to pay those fees. So here you have to, it says no transaction fee, but you're gonna have to pay it at some point. Nothing is truly free on the blockchain. So gasless, no transaction needed, won't appear in your wallet until transfer to purchase. So at some point, you're gonna have to pay the gas fee, okay? And here's where it makes you log in and all that type of stuff. So here, I don't know how much it costs. I have to look into there. Because some websites, this is why I didn't wanna go down this route, because it becomes complicated at this point. Because in order to mint, it depends on the blockchain in which you're minting upon. So you could put stuff on the Ethereum blockchain. You could put it on the, you know, there's other blockchains that you can put it on. So not every blockchain is the same. So for example, if I wanted to mint something here, let's say it costs me, how much is ETH to US? So it's one ETH is 3,000. So let's say it costs me 0.1 ETH to mint to something. So that would cost me $300 to even put it onto this platform. If they used Ethereum as their, remember that layers chart that I showed you? If they're minting onto Ethereum, you would have to pay around, let's just make up a number, say $300 per upload. So this is not like upload a volume of stuff and do it that way. No, this is every single time you put up something, it costs you $300 to put up a product, I should say. And that's the tricky part of all this. Is finding, like Nicholas said, those platforms that offer cheap gas fees or really low gas fees. Now, I don't know the whole science behind it, so I just want to avoid the conversation of why certain gas fees are higher than others. But also think about if the gas fee for Ethereum is $500, I think that's a good thing because that prevents Joe Schmo and 1,000,000,000 people from putting stuff onto the blockchain, which then keeps everything valuable, in my opinion. So that they don't put crap on the blockchain. Now, other blockchains that are cheaper, in my opinion, if everybody can put something on the blockchain, then I feel like the quality is gonna go down because people don't actually believe in their product, in my opinion. So that's one thing I would say is an advantage for high gas prices as opposed to cheaper gas prices. So you have different platforms like Polygon, and I haven't even studied Polygon, so I don't even wanna butcher what this actually does. But there's other protocols. Let's see. So Ethereum's Internet of Blockchains. I don't even understand this level of it. So I'm not gonna get too geeky with y'all, but I've heard of Polygon, I've heard of Matic and Polkadot and blah, 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 blah. It's such an overwhelming world, but I'm trying to study case by case. So who was asking the question about minting? Was that? Hopefully that answered your question. For the market cap. Oh, you said, how do you upload NFTs? Yeah, you have to do a process called minting, which means you put it into an immutable or unchangeable blockchain. So whatever you put up there cannot be changed unless you burn it, it's called, to take it off of the blockchain. Okay, so that's how you do it. And it costs you money though. It's not free. There are websites where it's like almost free. But again, if you're doing something that everybody can do, it means that your thing is gonna, you're gonna be fighting against supply. If everybody can do it, that means you're just part of the noise. We still need to find an actual use case. The thing is, how are artists gonna get paid for their art if the content is free? How can you monetize your art? So I forgot to answer that first part. How do you monetize something that is widely spreadable? And that goes back to that pure ownership aspect. Because anybody can copy and paste the Drake album, technically. So what makes the masters different from the listening experience? It's the ownership. It's the ability to put it in movies. It's the ability. Now, that's the copyright ownership, but it's the ability to earn money from it. It's the royalties. It's all that type of stuff as to why you want to own the Drake song as opposed to just listening to it. All right, but what is the main? Da, da, da. What is the main? Oh, I answered that right. New beat challenge. That's a good question. We can come up with a new beat challenge. I didn't realize crypto was this dense until I had to share it with you guys. I did not realize it was this dense. So, which means I need to simplify this a lot more. Because if I had to explain it for 2 hours for myself to even get out what I had to say, then I can imagine what it means to people who have no idea even still what I'm talking about. Binance saving. Oh, yeah. So, DeFi is another aspect I forgot to explain. So this is, so again, if you're just starting and you're watching the replay of this stream, just look into things like Coinbase, just to keep it really, really, really simple, because you have to start somewhere and chances are you're not going to understand how to use crypto wallets just yet, which means you're going to be putting your own money at risk, like true risk. And I don't want that to happen to you. So start at Coinbase. This is the easiest way to get in my opinion. Now, there's also stuff called DeFi, which this is for the really advanced people out there. DeFi is when you, how can I explain DeFi in a really simple way? So you know how you go to a bank and get like $1 million loan? You can do that with DeFi. It's just the way they collect their money is different. So they're willing to take more quote unquote risk, because it's, you could do like fractionalized liquidity pools and all types of stuff. It's still such a dense, let me see if I can pull it up. See if we can find a picture, because pictures always help. When everything, when there's something that's super complicated, I found pictures usually help. Okay, so a liquidity pool is basically this simple. Yeah, I guess it's really that simple. Is when you have people who need money and then people who are willing to give the money. And so the way it works to keep it stable for everybody is it's a constant flow. It's a constant flow. So you have people who are borrowing at a constant flow and you have people who are being paid back at a constant flow. So all the risk doesn't go into one person. It goes, the risk is really on the pool itself. And the whole goal of the pool is to keep it balanced. You don't want the water to be too high because then the water will overflow and go into the grass, but you don't want the water to be too low because then you can't swim in the pool anymore. So the goal is to keep it going up and down, keep the loans balanced with the people putting in the money for it to be loanable. So the equivalent would be the lenders are the people putting water into the pool and the borrowers are the people coming by the pool with buckets to take the water out of the pool. So if you have too many borrowers, you have everybody dipping their bucket in the pool to where there's no more water for people to swim. But if there's too little lenders, then you don't have enough water to begin with to even make a pool. And if you have too many lenders, which is sounds like a crazy problem to have, like rich people problems, then the pool is overflowing and money becomes cheap at that point. But the problem with that is when the money supply goes up like that, then the demand goes down, which means people aren't willing to even borrow from you. They don't have a need to borrow from you, which means you don't make money on your money at that point. So you have to keep a balance of supply and demand, as we talked about before. But think of it like an actual pool. You have people who put the water into the pool and people who take the water out of the pool. But the cool way, the cool understanding about that is the way you pay people back is based on transactions. So if you guys use Shopify, for example, you can go to Shopify and I think, let me see, Shopify considered DeFi? Let's see. They might call this FinTech, actually. I think they call it FinTech. But basically, FinTech is this in a nutshell. Let's say you have a Shopify account and you want to borrow $10,000 from Shopify themselves. They're willing to give you some money to put into ads to get your website going. So you borrow $10,000, you put your money in ads. Now they get their money back not based on you making monthly payments. They get their money back based on how much transaction you pull through Shopify. So they'll take a small cut every time your customers buy something until they're paid back. So it's a different way of paying people back their loans is this thing called fintech, for example. DeFi is similar. I don't know the ins and outs, but it's very similar. And the way that you pay people back is not based on you taking a loan for $100,000 and then owing somebody a monthly bill every month. It's based on how much transaction volume you move, and they take a small cut of that transaction volume to pay themselves back. That's how I believe it works. Hopefully I didn't confuse anybody. There's a much better explanation. A good channel for this is actually called Finimatics or Finimatics. This guy is like a genius. Now his accent is a little heavy for me, but he's like a super genius at describing DeFi, crypto, all types of stuff. So this guy's, he's a very good technical explainer, but I have another channel called What Happened to Common Sense. And he speaks in like regular people terminology, but he's still really smart about this. So there's another channel, What Happened to Common Sense. And those two channels combined will give you a really nice foundation to the fundamentals of crypto and all this. Now, if you're just trying to figure out what people are being influenced by, like crypto influencers, there's a guy, Alex Becker. He's like a crypto influencer. So the stuff he talks about actually causes people to go look at the projects and then invest in those projects. So every time he makes a video about Polkadot, people go, oh, I should buy Polkadot. And they go buy Polkadot. And then again, that cycle of what people are willing to pay, it, the price goes up basically based on how much focus people have on that thing. And so that's what his channel is mostly about, is this is the hype beast type part. He has some solid information, but it's mostly like hype beast type stuff. So that's his channel. Something else. Oh, DeFi. Yeah, liquidity pools. There's yield farming. There's all this type of stuff. Staking. So let me see if there's a last point I can make. DeFi staking. So this is a concept that I'm not so versed in because I don't understand the network part of crypto. But when people, I'll say when they stake in your project, I need a good graphic about staking. There's this process of like validation or something like this to where you have to verify that stuff is actually happening the way it is. And so it has to run a bunch of computer processes from what I understand to verify that that thing has happened. So they used to use these GPUs graphics cards. That's the reason why if you ever tried to build a computer in the past 4 years and you were wondering why the graphics cards were all sold out, it's because crypto miners, Bitcoin miners, were going out buying these graphics cards for their computers so that they could have these really fast computers so that they could run transactions on computing things on their computer, and it needed a lot of power. So the way Bitcoin worked is that the only way you could mine it is by solving this really hard problem. And basically it was just like based on your computer power, how many things it could do, that was like the odds of winning the Bitcoin. It's complicated, it's freak. But the point I'm trying to make is that instead of using these kind of, they're called nodes, N-O-D-E-S, as like a way to connect the network. Let me see if there's a better way to show this. Crypto nodes. Let us see. So this is kind of how it works. This is a better picture. So with the crypto world, again, the reason it's so powerful is because computer one, remember the whisper down the lane effect? Like if this person tells the next person, hey, I got a new dog. Now this person, if you've ever played as a kid, whisper down the lane, you know that by the time it gets around to person 10 and back to you, it's a whole different message. It'll be like, my dog is yellow. You're like, that's not what I told person one. I said, I got a new dog. And then the message comes back to you and it's like, my dog is yellow. And the reason that happens is because there's distortion of the signal, or the information, I should say. So with crypto stuff in the blockchain, they've made it to where the message you send out cannot be changed. It's immutable. So by the time it comes back around to you, it's the same message that you put out. And that sounds simplified, but that's the easiest understanding of what the network effect is. And so you have to have the people in your whisper down the lane kind of line who are considered nodes. And these nodes are like people in a circle, if you've ever played Whisper Down the Lane. And node, the problem with a node is that you can take out person five, and then now you've screwed up the whole Whisper Down the Lane effect, because now person three has to like lean all the way over to person, person four has to lean all the way over to person six. And so it creates more stress in the system. And more in the whole point to all this is to decentralize it so that there's no one point that anybody can take out to destroy everything. So there's this process called staking, and I'm trying to find a good picture for it. But from what I understand, staking is like, I don't have it in my head strong enough to really give you an equivalent image. But from what I understand, and I'm willing to be corrected here, staking is similar to nodes. It's that people are dedicating money and keeping it there. Let's say all these people were individual businesses, for example. They're willing to stake some money into your business so that it verifies this whole ecosystem of movement. That's probably not the greatest example because that doesn't even make sense. So let me shut up. I know when to shut up, and that's the perfect time to shut up. So I don't have a good explanation for staking, but I've heard it's spectacular. And people, it's like investing in companies, and you can earn returns based on, let me see, is there a DeFi farm yield? DeFi yield farming, how to get DeFi yield. So you could look that up to get more information, because this is the world I'm not used to, investing in all this. But basically, people want to consistently get higher and higher returns. So they manage it to where if something's getting 6% and then something else has a 10% return, they'll move the 6% to the 10% because they're trying to get that maximum yield. And that's what yield farming is all about. Now, that's like master's degree level finance. I don't get it. Crypto education live streams normally or no, would you love to see? I just want people from the music industry to not be so afraid of cryptocurrency and just make it more of a normal conversation, because it's not that complicated. As I'm saying this out loud, all this technical stuff, technically you don't even need to know any of what I just said. You could just go to Coinbase, invest in whatever coin you like, call it a day, and look at your account every day. You don't have to get into NFTs and all this other stuff if you don't want to. I just joined the stream. I asked what's being discussed here. We were talking about the future of music and why it's important to musicians. So here's the last point I'll make, because we've been going for what? 2 hours almost? Is because we have DeFi and because we have these things called NFTs. Let me see if there's a better picture. NFT, DeFi. You can basically create these digital assets or these things that are going to go up in value over time, called assets. You could take these digital assets like your song or your NFT art or whatever it is, and then you can have people give you loans or staking and different DeFi stuff. I don't know all the names for it, but basically a loan, to make it short, against your NFT. So for example, if I had one of the CryptoPunks that are worth worth 7 million? Goodness. If I had the crypto punk worth 7 million, I can then go to one of these DeFi platforms to then take a loan against my crypto punk because it's collateral, it's called. So it's digital collateral. So I can go to these digital kind of liquidity pools or DeFi mechanisms. Again, there's no banks in this world, in the crypto world. There's no like Bank of America, there's no Wells Fargo. So all those tools that the banks were using, we can use them as people. And that's the crazy part that is hard to understand, because you'll start to realize how much power banks have just because of how it was. So DeFi is like being your own bank, basically. And I can go to a DeFi platform, for example, and take my $8 million CryptoPunk, and I'll keep this in some type of escrow situation to where if I don't pay you back your loan, you could take away my CryptoPunk. And then they own the CryptoPunk worth $8 million. But they'll give me $8 million worth of Ethereum in exchange for my actual asset of the CryptoPunk. So I don't know how it works on the tech part, but that's the concept. You're just creating collateral. In the case that you don't pay your loan back, they could take your collateral. So I'm trying to think of stuff we used to do as a kid. Like, you would say to your parents, hey, mom or dad, you would be like, if I don't get an A in this class, you could take my Xbox or my PlayStation, whatever. So your PlayStation or your Xbox is your collateral to your parents. You're saying to your parents that you're going to get an A, okay? But they're loaning you the PlayStation, the joy of playing the PlayStation. Actually, they're not loaning you the collateral. They're loaning you the fact that you're not going to get your behind whooped. That's what they're loaning you. So you go to your parents and you're like, hey, here's my Xbox. And if I don't get this A in this class, you can take my Xbox. So I'm bringing the collateral of my PlayStation or my Xbox to my parents. And my parents are saying, if you get an A, you can keep it, AKA, you can continue to have all this joy that you want from your Xbox or PlayStation. But if you don't get your A that you promised me, we're gonna take your Xbox or PlayStation until you get your stuff together, and then you can buy it back, so to speak, with your grades. So that's the equivalent of what you can do with NFTs. So to switch it up, the NFT would be like your Xbox. So you go to your parent, AKA the lender, and you say, hey, lender, I have this collateral called an NFT, AKA a PlayStation or an Xbox. Will you give me the equivalent value in cash so that I could use it to go do stuff? And I only need 4,000 Ethereum, okay? So you give them that thing as collateral against the loan, and then you take out the loan for 4,000 Ethereum to do whatever you want, hopefully to get a return. And then you owe them their money back plus interest. So the goal is to get an NFT, borrow against the NFT, AKA use it to get cash again. Okay, so you use cash, or whatever the currency is, I'll just say cash. Use cash to buy an NFT. Take the NFT to loan cash out as debt. And then you take the debt and then you then buy more stuff. Okay, then you make money from that stuff and you do the same thing over and over and over and over and over again. That's what the ultimate goal of this stuff is. It same thing happens in real estate. If I go and I buy a home right now, I can take out a home equity loan against my home. So I could buy a $100,000 home. I can go to a bank and say, hey, bank, I have this $100,000 house. I'm going to use this as collateral to get a loan from you guys. Just give me $100,000 cash. So now I can go buy a house for $20,000, get $100,000 from the bank, then take the $100,000, go buy another house, okay, for let's say $30,000 down or whatever. Then the $70,000, I could use that to pay off the first bank, and just on and on and on. That's the secret to it. It's a little advanced. I know I'm getting a little weird, wordy with it. You don't have any friends this isn't real life who are not at all interested. True. I haven't even invested in NFTs yet. I'm still in the baby waters on Coinbase Pro. That's as far as I've gone so far. Done a lot of studying, but I need to do more because as I'm saying this out loud, I'm realizing how much I actually don't know, which is insane. I didn't realize how dense this was. So I'm gonna end this here because there's really nothing else I wanted to show you outside of, oh, and the point, oh, here's the last point I was trying to make, my bad. So you can upload a music NFT, for example, and then use one of those DeFi lenders to loan against your money. I mean, excuse me, loan against your music or whatever you create that's an NFT, and then use that to do whatever you want, like run a business, buy business stuff. There's a gazillion things you could do with this currency stuff. So that's the ultimate game, is it allows people to like operate, like I don't know how else to say it, but that's so anyway. It currently exists right now. Like, if you have a music catalog, you can actually get a loan against your music catalog, your publishing, your future payments. That's what you can get a loan against, and most people don't know that. Excuse me, with music. So that's the type of stuff that you guys weren't exposed to for the most part. What is this? Is that Elon Musk? That's random. So I'm going to wrap it because I need to study more so that I don't sound like a blob. But thank you everybody for hopping in with me and good luck with this stuff. It is dense, but again, if you just want to hop on in, the two websites you need are CoinMarketCap to look at the general price. Again, what you want to look at is the market cap. And the way I understand it is that the more money something has in its market cap, the more people believe in that thing. That's the easiest way to understand it. Then you want to go to Coinbase. And this is where you can use your real US money to buy these cryptocurrencies. And the reason you want to buy these cryptocurrencies, for example, let me go to my holdings real quick. So I've seen, I put in a little tiny money. I haven't put in big money yet. I put in a little bit of money in like 3 days. I had 10% gains off of four cryptocurrencies. And let me see right now. Yeah, so one went up from, because we're in a bull market also, that's the reason why the returns are so high. So I don't want to get into what a bull market is. But basically, you just get crazy returns in a short amount of time. And that's, we're looking for the long hold. But even still, the fact that you could go from $100 to $120, let's be fair. Let's say you can go from $100 to $110 by, you know, 4 days from now. That's the crazy part about crypto. Now, if you put that same $100 into your banking account and put it into savings, you're losing money by default. You're not gaining anything. So that's the difference. And I don't want to hype you up on like the crypto returns because it's a volatile market, but it's like a relationship. It's just like you're going to have the down days. You're going to have the super up days. Hopefully you get more ups than downs. But that's the gist, and it's not complicated. I don't buy into the cheesy stuff like the Safe Moons and the Doge coins and all that. The stuff that I'm in is Solana. Let me show you. And again, this is not financial advice. I'm just sharing what I've heard of. I'm in Chainlink, Uniswap, Solana, Cardano, Ether, and eventually I'm going to put that into Bitcoin. So the whole game, once you get into it, like investing, you invest in the coins that move a lot, and then you put your returns into the stuff that doesn't move a lot. Like Bitcoin doesn't move that dramatically. It's a long-term kind of storing of value. So this is a way for one to get money to fund their music, right? Well, even outside of investing in crypto, you can use your music to earn crypto, which is called NFTs. And we're going to have more information on that soon enough. So I'm going to try to simplify all this and boil it down to the basics. Maybe I'll even make a course around this. Just something to get you guys into all this stuff because it's exciting. It makes music exciting again, knowing that you're actually receiving the value you deserve for your music. It's very exciting. And that's all I wanted to say. So I don't keep belaboring the point. Thank you all for hopping in with me. Thank you all for all the good questions. And I'm going to go research so I could sound more educated next time. Peace. Wait, you said I'm pretty sure it's safe. Yeah, a lot of this stuff is called SHIT coin instead of Bitcoin. They call it SHIT coin. And it's just, that's why I said you got to do research on like, let's see, how many projects on Ethereum? So the reason Ethereum is so powerful is because, again, it's a virtual machine. It's a virtual computer, basically. Bitcoin is not, it's not like Ethereum because Bitcoin doesn't have as many applications. You can't do as much stuff on Bitcoin that you can do on Ethereum. And that's for a reason. They don't want Bitcoin to be hacked and abused and all this type of stuff. Whereas Ethereum, you could do a lot of stuff on Ethereum. And I'm trying to figure out how many apps are on this thing. 220, is that it? So this says there's 220 projects on Ethereum. I don't know if this is accurate, but it seems like it. So imagine 200, it's, okay, here's my last point. The last of the last. So if you go to a shopping mall center, like those outdoor shopping malls, you have what are called anchor tenants. So like a Walmart, a Target, a Bed Bath & Beyond, Barnes & Noble, that type of stuff. So depending on how many anchor tenants you have in a shopping mall, it will determine the type of businesses that come to lease those other spaces in that shopping mall. Now, if you don't have any anchor tenants, you're not going to attract all those other smaller shops because those smaller shops are banking on the anchor tenants' traffic to come to the shopping mall. So for example, if you were next to a Walmart, you would get all the excess foot traffic from the Walmart to go to your burger shop because you're in proximity to Walmart. Whereas if the Walmart didn't exist there, it'd be like half impossible to get people to come into the shopping center. So what I'm trying to say is that the more big projects we have on each protocol, like Ethereum, these are like anchor tenants. So if more and more big projects get built on Ethereum, the more anchor tenants it will have, therefore driving the traffic or people's attention over to Ethereum. And then that's how you're going to look at the longevity of something. How many legitimate projects are being built on this thing? Like, for example, if I scroll down this list, you probably heard of this stuff. Now, those other coins like SafeMoon and all that, we have to look at their list of projects. SafeMoon projects. Or Dogecoin. I don't think it has any projects on it. I don't know about SafeMoon, so I don't want to speak against it because I don't know about it. It's whatever, except fastest growing crypto community on Earth. Okay, but what projects are on it? Or is it a project itself? I don't know. I don't know how this works. Never heard of SafeMoon. I would have to do more research. But let's look at Ethereum. So if I scroll down the Ethereum list of stuff, you've probably heard of some of these projects. Yeah, you have to do a lot of research. I don't even know what SafeMoon is. That's how focused I am on one thing at a time. So anyway, Coinbase, you've probably heard of Coinbase. You've probably heard of MetaMask, which is like a wallet that you can use, aka like an email address type thing that holds all your stuff. Rainbow, for those who are more into crypto, you've heard of that. Rainbow Bridge. So these are pretty, like, just those names alone are pretty huge. All these other projects I'm not familiar with. And again, all these are like apps built on a computer. Yearn Finance, I've heard of that one before. Curve, I've heard of that. It's like a liquidity thing. Liquality, I've heard of that one. So again, SushiSwap, heard of that. So Uniswap, heard of that. And so all these things are built on Ethereum. And the more big, it's just like plugins in FL Studio. Like the more dope plugins you have in FL Studio, the higher the chances that people are gonna buy FL Studio because it has all the dope sounds and the dope plugins. Chainlink is huge. So that's what I'm trying to get at. So again, I'm surprised you guys are that knowledgeable about the crypto world. A lot of smart people in here. And I could probably learn from you guys. So I'm thinking about starting a Discord. We'll look into it. I don't want to get too off track yet. But that is that. And I forgot why I said that. I forgot why I showed you that whole chart. Oh, that's before you buy like cryptocurrencies, check out the stuff that they're building on the cryptocurrency. Like Ethereum and all that type of stuff. Or what it's used for. But you can't really miss. Like I just put my, again, I put my investments into four simple things and I'm already up 10% without doing anything. Like without knowing much. And I'm not telling you this is not financial advice. I have my stuff. Ethereum was sitting somewhere around like 2,500. I knew that was pretty low and it went back up to 3,400, for example. Cardano was pretty low and I bought it. So Cardano, Solana, I just have faith in these projects. Uniswap, I just bought some. Chainlink, I just bought some. And it's just going up because every day they're creating new stuff to go on top of this stuff. So it's only getting bigger. So you're investing in the money that will be used to buy things in the future. You're investing in that money. That's how that works. It's complicated, but that's how it works. All right, so I'll shut up because I have a lot to learn. So peace.